church. Some of you, I can almost sense cringing at this loud joy song on a day that's meant to be solemn and a time of remembrance. And I get it. And I want to kind of take a moment just to set up today to kind of walk you through how we're going to find a really cool balance between this truth that we can have joy in any situation, but also taking a time to honor and have that solemn moment of remembrance. So the way we're going to do it today is we're going to have a message now, and we're going to gather again in reflective worship. But that's all going to come to an end probably at about 5 after 11, at which time there's this video that I've kind of stitched together. And that video will walk us through just a reason to reflect and remember. And that'll go right into, and I don't know the two, it's the, Michael, you would know, the two trumpet songs. The Ruse, the
Reveille
is the second one, right?
Gospel.
Yeah, I'm not sure. But anyways, it'll we're going to do that, and we'll have a moment of silence as well. So that's all going to be built in. And one of the things I think I need to say right off the bat is the message today, the word that I'm bringing to you is not a Remembrance Day message. That's very important that you understand that. I'll remind you a couple times through, because if you start making connections to Remembrance Day and to the issues that surround Remembrance Day, you're going to be making some incorrect connections. All right? So I need to make that very clear. I also would like to start by giving you an update on Greg Wilde. And it's a tough one. I'm not going to go into all of the details, but he's been given a very negative prognosis this week. It's been a really tough week as far as the kind of the medical side of things. And I'm really, this is one of those things that it's been a wrestling match in my prayer life. And, but even there's these sparks of joy that comes out of these weird places. When I think about just the wrestling itself, I think that's something that God likes from us. I think he likes it when we dig into his word and really evaluate what is true about this. What does God say about this? I think he likes it when we engage in prayer in a fervent way. And it's not like he dangles these negative situations to push us to pray, but you know what? He can redeem hard stories for his glory. And I believe that one of the things he's just doing in my life, and your testimony might be the same, is that he's really kind of pushing me into battle. And you know what? I know the benefits of battle. Like, for me, if you look at my body, you'll see I don't battle enough probably at times, right? I'm getting squishier and squishier. And it's because I'm not necessarily, like, when you exercise, you're actually working out, you're almost doing battle and getting your body ready. And the same thing can happen spiritually. When everything's just going great all the time, you can get kind of squishy in your faith. You can get soft in your faith. And there are times when we're called to battle. And so this is what I believe about Greg and about healing. It doesn't matter how negative the prognosis is. God has raised people from the dead. There, even death isn't too big an issue for God. And so, despite the fact things have kind of taken a backward step for Greg, we believe that God can get even more glory. He'll blow even more minds in healing. And so we pray, and we just keep going at it. Okay, we march on in prayer for Greg. And I want to pray for him together. Again, if you wouldn't mind holding hands with the person next to you, I'd really like to come together in unity on this. Actually, you know what? Let's stand and hold hands. Let's stand and hold hands. That way some of you can bridge some gaps here. There you go. Here we go. Heavenly Father, we know there are some things we know. We know that you love Greg. We know you want to care for him. We know you look at him as a father looks at a son. And you want wholeness for Greg. We know that's your will. But we also know that there are different reasons for sicknesses. And sometimes it plays a part of a story or something. And your will for the big picture supersedes and it trumps the will for individual healing. But God, we are coming to you and we are asking that you would heal Greg, because we know that you can. And so, Father, we pray together for Greg's complete and total healing. Not so that we could just have more of Greg, but so that you can be made famous, Lord, that you can be made known as the God who heals today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated. Okay. Well, in just a moment, you're going to get your first taste of why I don't want you making connections between the message today and Remembrance Day. Because the very first word, I got to turn my thing on here, the very first word of the message is forget. On Remembrance Day, it's a weird way to start. Now, you're going to find a couple of oddities here. But I'm really hoping in the end that there's a connection or a bridge to be made between what we're teaching today and what we want to do as a point of remembrance. The key verse today in Philippians 3, verses 13 and 14, is forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. That's a key verse, and we're going to come back to that later. I want you to kind of have that in your mind. Here's the big idea. And if you look at our title slide, I don't know if you can read that bottom thing here, but it's from Philippians 3, so we're going to see this today as well. Philippians 3:20 says, our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. So we're talking about being citizens of heaven. As citizens of heaven, we ought not get distracted by the issues of earth. Again, don't connect this to Remembrance Day, all right? We shouldn't get distracted by the issues of earth. Instead, our drive and focus is on bigger things. As citizens of heaven, can you get that kind of idea in your head that you are a citizen of heaven? When you become a child of God, you are a citizen of heaven. Even that word, I don't want to undercut what the Word of God says, but that word doesn't tell the whole story. We're not just going to someday have an address in heaven. We are going to reign with God in heaven. We are princes and princesses in the heavenly kingdom. So this whole idea of citizenship is a big deal. We have a destination. We have a hope for eternal life with God. And as citizens of heaven, what should naturally happen is that there's almost this trivialness to the stuff of earth. Again, don't make the connection to Remembrance Day. In fact, I'm going to make a bit of a bridge because I'm nervous about where your brains are going right now. Have you ever heard the saying that a person is so heavenly minded that they're of no earthly good? You heard that? Okay, we are citizens of heaven, and I do believe this to be true, that we are called to bigger things than just the issues of earth. However, Remembrance Day is a beautiful bridge opportunity. Despite the fact that we know that we serve a victorious king, and that ultimately all of this is going to be dust, okay? And we are going to live forever and reign with God in eternity. Even though we know that, there are points in our earthly life where we need to walk with skill. Remembrance Day is one of those days. I love what Matt said at the beginning in announcements. He talked about how the point of the poppy isn't political. It's not pro-war or against war. It's a matter of remembering that ultimate sacrifice that people gave for us. A beautiful picture of Jesus' ultimate sacrifice for our benefit. And we can do that, even though we are heavenly minded, we are citizens of heaven, and our focus and our drive is meant to be there. We can do that in the earthly realm. We can take points to be solemn and remember and be thankful. It's the same thing as with a birthday. We don't want to say, oh, I'm not going to celebrate your birthday. That's such a little thing. Don't you know we are citizens of heaven and there are bigger, more important things? We can enjoy a birthday party. We can exchange Christmas gifts, even though Jesus is not the reason we give gifts. Well, you can make that connection. But really, we can just enjoy the fun stuff of Christmas, even though we are heavenly minded. Because we have this life to live on earth, we need to live it with skill and effectiveness. And if we are so heavenly minded that we're of no earthly good, then we're going to be of no earthly good. Okay? So, but we do have a drive for bigger things. We're going to go right through the scripture. In fact, I think the rest of the slides are all Philippians chapter 3. We're going to pick up in verse 2. If you'd like to read your Bible, you can. But this is the English Standard Version. We can read through this together. This is really going away from a Remembrance Day theme. So again, don't make that connection. If you've read a part here, you'll see where we're going. By the way, has anybody read ahead Philippians 3? Did you do some pre-reading, some homework? Yeah, well done. Good, good. Is anybody wondering how on earth I'm going to make a connection between that and Remembrance Day in the end? Yeah, me too. All right, look out for the dogs. And this is not literally dogs. This is not God saying the dogs are bad. He's not a cat person. I know God is not a cat person. Right? Well, put my foot in. All right, look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. Let me explain that, the context of this idea of mutilating the flesh. He's responding to this teaching that's happening in the church. This issue for the people of Philippi, that there is a group of people, a cult really, that's formed at that time and is teaching that you cannot be saved unless you are circumcised. And so they were calling for adults to be circumcised. And they were putting this religious duty as a gateway, as a pathway to salvation. And that if you're not circumcised, you can't be a citizen of heaven. And Paul is writing, look out for these guys. And he says it for this reason. For we are the circumcision. I was going to get you to chant that today. That we are the circumcision. And I thought, no, that would make me a bit much. And I don't know if you want to get a t-shirt that says, I am the circumcision. But let me explain that too. We are the circumcision, who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus, and put no confidence in the flesh. Therein lies the point. These mutilators of the flesh, these cult members who are teaching that everybody has to be circumcised, they are putting confidence in the flesh, in what they can do. It's about what they can do, and if they do it right, they can be citizens of heaven. Paul's saying that we are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. It's not about what we can do in our religiosity. It's about what God can do and what God does. Does that make sense? Let's move along here. Verses 4 to 6. Though I myself, now this is Paul. He doesn't want people to think that he's just saying, you don't have to be circumcised, because he just really, really doesn't want to get circumcised. I would be saying that to you if that was the case. But though I myself have no reason for confidence in the flesh also. Though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also. If anyone else thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I've got more. Now he's going to brag about how Jewish he is, I guess. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Paul was the ultimate Jew. As he said here, his lineage was pure Jew. He had gone through the rituals that Jewish people go through. He talks about understanding the law. He was a Pharisee. He was a law worshiper, really. He attended to all of the rules. As far as zeal, remember, Paul believed so strongly against what was rising up in Christian faith, the ones who were following Christ, who were following what he believed to be a, false, but, oh my goodness. A heresy.